Hi guys! Maybe you feel the same way as me and you never thought about how the square root of a number is computed. It was just there, right? So ask yourself, could you compute the square root right now with pen and paper? Personally, I just took it for granted that there is a button on my calculator that I could press and magically the root number appeared in front of me. But have you ever thought about what is going on in there? I mean, what's really happening under the hood when a square root is being processed? Today, we will witness pure elegance when we investigate the Heron method, also called the Babylonian method. It is named after Heron of Alexandria, a Greek mathematician. In his book Metrica, he introduced a way how to retrieve the square root of a number in an iterative manner. And I promise you, after you have seen the approach, you will ask yourself why you did not came up with that. Its simplicity makes it so enjoyable. So, let's jump right into it. To begin with, we want to compute the square root of 25, which is 5, of course. How can we approximate the root now? First of all, we imagine a rectangle with the area 25. For simplicity, we claim one side is 25 long, and the other one has to be of length 1, which yields the area of 25. Now, the whole trick is, step by step, iteration by iteration, we will transform the rectangle into a square. In each step, we must maintain the condition that the area of the rectangle stays 25, that's the whole deal. In each step, one side gets shorter, and the other one gets longer, making them more equally. At some point, we obtain a rectangle with 4 approximately equal sides, which can be considered a square. That's the point where the algorithm stops, because the only thing we need to do is to return the side length of the square. Why? Since we are looking at a square of area 25, its side length must be square root 25 long, which is 5, and therefore the number we are looking for. Take a second to digest that. We started with a rectangle, transformed it into a square, and kept the area all the time the same. Then we automatically received a square root. With that motivation in our mind, we are curious now how the rectangle is exactly transformed, or in other words, how the side lengths are changed in each step. Again, we take the example of 25. We simply take the average of the long side and the short side. And if you think about it, that makes totally sense in order to bring the two sides closer together in length. The new obtained value of 13 will be assigned to the long side and therefore replaces 25 as side length. The next step is very important. Remember, in each step, we must maintain the condition of the area of 25. Since one side length is fixed now, the 13, we have only one choice for the short side. Pause the video and do the math for yourself to understand that we still have an area of 25. The long side was shrinked and the short side was extended, but the area was never changed. This process gets repeated again and again recursively. What we did earlier can be described like this. This formula generalizes each recursion step. Stay with me on this. This is basically exactly what you have seen before. No crazy voodoo is happening here. Instead of observing a rectangle getting shorter, we formulate it now rigorously with that formula. The 1/2 is the averaging that we have seen before. Inside of the parentheses, we add up the long and the short side together. The long side is the result from the previous step, and the short side is the corresponding ratio. Nothing scary. This only works because the area stayed the same. So let's plug everything in for our example of 25. We start with 25 and average it in the first iteration. We have seen that 1 minute ago. It's just 13. 13 will then be used in the next iteration, and so on and so forth. Then we can let the recursion do its magic. until at some point some stopping criterion is met and our result is accurate enough. That's where we stop. The square root is 5. Note, on the road I got some rounding errors. However, the approach is relatively robust against errors, so the derivation from the real root is negligible. The code for Heron's method seems relatively unspectacular. First, I set the initial guess to a given number x. Keep in mind that this initial guess does not have to be the number itself necessarily. This was just an arbitrary decision to motivate the geometrical approach from earlier. We could set it to almost any number, but we will come back to that later. Afterwards, we iterate over and over again just to update the approximation in each step. Take a moment to compare the Python code to the formula from earlier. An extended version of my code makes it a bit more flexible by adding another stopping criterion. If the approximation change is small enough, we just stop and take the estimation that we received until that point. Great! Now that we have a functional implementation, we can start computing some square roots with Heron's method. In our playground example, we examined a real square number. The method, however, works on any number. It only must be positive. On negative numbers, the algorithm does not converge and jumps back and forth. Let's double check. What impressed me the most is the fact that Heron's method converges pretty fast. Even with numbers of unthinkable magnitude, we don't have to wait a second. A little side explanation here. Heron's method has quadratic convergence, meaning the number of correct digits roughly doubles with each iteration. Accurately enough for us. Another fun fact about Heron's method is that it is some kind of specialization of Newton's approach, which is a way to find the zeros of a function f. The function here is simply x squared minus the number we want a square root of. It took me a bit to digest that. Doing the math here really helps to get a full understanding here. In the special case of Heron, the two approaches are equivalent. We could end the video now. You know everything about Heron's method to get started. But there's one parameter that we can tinker around with. Do you remember the initial guess for our starting point, our x0? This value can be considered as some kind of seed value, which determines the sequence of approximations. You could choose any number, 1000, pi, 42, even a number smaller than the real square root. Careful! If the number is negative, then interestingly, the approach converges to the negative square root. The reason for that is irrelevant here in this video, but it makes sense if you consider Newton's method. Anyways, a reasonable choice for the initial guess lies of course below a. The closer we set the starting point to the real square root, the faster we terminate. Let's run some experiments. To make things a bit more transparent, let's choose a large number and compute the square root of it. Why not take about 150 million, which is approximately the distance between Earth and Sun? In the following, I will walk you over this plot that visualizes the convergence for finding the square root, with four different initial guesses and their conversions. It is not important what we take as initial guess, the algorithm will converge in any case. The question is, how fast will it arrive at an accurate approximation? We see four lines. Remember the rectangle explanation from the beginning? Here we started with the number itself as an initial guess. We could also just start with 1. Look at the plot more closely to blue and yellow. As you can see from the first iteration onwards, the guesses result in the exact same sequence of approximations. Why? The rectangle does not care which side is 1 and which side is the number itself. It's not a bad choice, but we can do better. A simple but yet battle-proven option is just halving the given number and take the starting point. That works because we could bound the square root and shrink the interval. As always, it's best to set your seed value to your advantage. What we could also do, we could find the closest perfect square number and start from here. As an example, think of 49 as start when you want to find the square root of 50. As you can see, it's almost unbeatable in terms of converging. The pink line flattens immediately. However, we have a complex overhead in finding the closest square. This is definitely not of constant complexity and takes some time. Choosing the initial guess is well discussed in the scientific community and has deserved its own Wikipedia article. Even though the choice of the initial guess is crucial for determination speed, Heron's method is quite robust and is able to converge pretty fast. That's all I will give you today about Heron's method. You might have guessed it already. Modern libraries and software systems are using more sophisticated algorithms to compute the square root of a number, like the inverse square root, which is a story for another time. Nonetheless, it is always impressive to see that one mathematician from over 2000 years ago invented a method that is still influencing our modern technology in a way that is both simple and elegant.